He lives. He is risen. In fact, he is risen indeed, and he walks with us and talks with us along life's way. And I trust that you've sensed that all this past week, especially during Holy Week. We know we're in a very unusual time, but the Lord has been with us and walking with us and living with us throughout the entire experience that each one of us has been having. And today, we especially want to lift up and rejoice in our King and our Lord, our risen Savior. One of the things that we're going to do here at this time in just a moment is see a bunch of pictures that many of you have sent. Obviously, we can't be together in reality, but we can be together virtually, and we're going to see lots of different pictures of people from the congregation that have been sent in. And as we go into those pictures, let me say this. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Please join with the rest of the congregation as they prepare for our worship service.
Happy Easter, everyone.
Happy Easter.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Happy Easter. We miss you.
From the Birmingham family. We miss you, Mount Bethel Church family.
He is risen indeed.
Can't wait to see you guys again.
Wonderful song the ladies have brought to us. And now this is kind of our normal time when we would have scripture and prayer in our service. And so we're going to have scripture today as well, but it's going to be a little bit unique. We're going to have some of our base camp sixth graders from the Wednesday program that are going to read some scripture for us here, appropriate for Easter Sunday morning. And by the way, our children's ministries have continued to flourish these weeks. The young people, the children have been receiving videos at home. I know our youth pastor has been calling youth and so on, keeping contact with them. Our Sunday school teachers also this past week have been calling up their students. In fact, probably into the hundreds of people have been called by various different ones of us throughout the congregation, those who are part of Bible studies and ministries and so on. So there's been a lot of contact together, especially during this past week. And so please listen to the scripture here in a moment that these are going to share for the Easter Sunday morning. And since it is our scripture and prayer time, just I want to say thank you to you on behalf of the church for your tithes and your offering. Many of you have given online, some have sent through the mail or dropped off, that type of thing. We just praise God for the way he is providing for the needs of the ongoing ministry of his church, and thank you for participating in that. Now please listen to our Base Camp sixth graders as they bring you God's word.
Luke 24. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the woman took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb.
They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus.
While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them.
In their fright, the woman bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen."
Thank you so much, young people. That was Gabe LeClaire with the last one. He is not here. He is risen. Death could not hold Jesus Christ in the grave. So would you join with us at home and sing these wonderful Easter songs, the first one about Christ arising up from the grave he arose.
Up from the grave he arose, with a mighty triumph for his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, he arose, hallelujah, Christ arose. Low in the grave he lay, Jesus my Savior, waiting the coming day, Jesus my
thanks and sing and triumph evermore. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say, rejoice. Jesus the Savior reigns, the God of truth and love. When he had purged our stains, he took his seat above. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say, rejoice. His kingdom cannot fail, he rules o'er earth and heaven. The keys of death and hell are to our Jesus give. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say, rejoice. And now let us rejoice with a number of people from our church who are answering this question, what does Easter mean to me? From their homes, but you'll see it here now on videotape. So rejoice with them in the meaning of Easter.
Good morning, everybody. I just wanted to talk about how 30 years ago I became a believer, and my wife, Debbie, had given me until the 28th of February to become a believer, because we were dating at the time, and she didn't let me know that. I became a believer on the 28th of February, and a few months later, we found ourselves on the very top of the ship we were working on. We were working on a cruise ship together, and by the funnel on the top of the cruise ship, and we watched the sunrise on Easter Sunday. I think it was the 19th of April, and we just the two of us were up there reading scriptures, reading from my brand new Bible that she'd bought me, and it was a very special time, and that was my first experience of Easter as a new creature in Christ, and beginning to understand about the Lord and his death and resurrection, and been a fantastic journey ever since, obviously. So that's my little story. God bless you all. I miss you all, and we'll hopefully see you soon.
When I think of Easter, of Jesus being raised from the dead, I think about myself. And this verse is one of my favorite verses in the Bible. It says, "We therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life." So I think of myself identifying with Christ, identifying with him, with his death, my old sinful nature and all that stuff died with him. And when he raised from the dead, I also was raised with him, it says here. So I think about that, my new identity in Christ.
Good morning. When I got up on Friday morning, I was a bit surprised to see snow all over the ground. It made me think of Ken Miedema's song, "Lord, make me clean like the new fallen snow," which comes from Isaiah 1:18. "Though your sins be as scarlet, they will be white as snow." And then coming up through that snow, I could see my daffodils and new life coming up everywhere. A beautiful symbol of Easter. By Christ's death upon the cross, I know that my sins have been paid in full. But without Jesus' resurrection 3 days later, my faith would certainly be meaningless. Because of Jesus' resurrection, I do not have to fear death, for I too will live forever. And because of Jesus' resurrection, I have a living Savior who is always with me. So Bill and I join all of you to celebrate this glorious day.
I just want to wish everybody a happy Easter and read the lyrics to a song that I used to sing. The name of the song is, "Yet When He Was on the Cross, I Was on His Mind. He knew me, yet he loved me. He whose glory makes the heavens shine, so unworthy of such mercy. And yet, when he was on the cross, I was on his mind." And that is the reason that we hope for eternity, that we hope to see our beloved ones there, that we hope to get through this virus, that we hope that we get to heaven. So until I see you in church, consider yourself with a virtual hug. And boy, have we got a lot of catching up to do. Blessings to all of you and have a great Easter.
What Easter means to me is I have often wondered which side of the line I would have been. Would I have been part of the crowd that yelled, "Crucify him," or would I have been one of the crowd that knelt at his feet as he's being crucified? It amazes me that he died for my sins personally, and that my sins personally put him on the cross. It goes to show me how much God loved me despite my otherness. And that I can never, ever repay him for this indescribable gift.
Every day I get to live in the knowledge that Jesus died on the cross, taking all my sins with him, and then he rose again. And because of that, I get to live with hope for today and hope for the future. And on Easter, I get to celebrate that with Christians all over the world.
What does Easter mean to you, Mommy?
If I had to sum it up in one word, I would say hope. As a kid, I remember Easter being all about traditions. Easter egg hunts and Easter baskets and making Easter candy and having Easter lunch. I knew it was about Jesus, but I didn't quite get it. And for that matter, not even know what Monday Thursday was. 12 years ago, I sat in a church service in Australia, sobbing while listening to the pastor go through the steps of crucifixion and what happens to your body. He explained what Jesus had to endure and why he did it for us. As I sat, I thought, why would he do this for me, a sinner who's unworthy of his grace? That's when it hit me. So now that we have a family of our own, as you can hear the other one in the background, we want to really focus on what this holiday is about and what Jesus did for us and why he did, basically why he did it for us. We were talking about Holy Week this week, and when we got to the story about Jesus dying on the cross, Magnolia started crying. I want us to always feel deeply on Friday about how Jesus died and why he died for us, but then on Sunday have joy and hope and thanksgiving in our hearts that he rose again.
Hi, boys and girls. It's been a long time since we've been able to do this, but as we came out of that little segment where we talked about what Easter means to me, I thought about something in a completely non-spiritual manner. I always think about these services that we get to do together. And so when I think of the big services that we'll have at Tuscarora or here at the church, the one thing I think about is this what's in the bag activity. But then I was remembering, this isn't Christmas, this is Easter. And at Easter, we always do a game called what's in the bonnet. So I called Mrs. Naismith and she brought me this beautiful little bonnet here, but this bonnet was too small to do the activity that I wanted to do with you. So what I want you to do is get real close to the TV and we're gonna play not necessarily what's in the bonnet, because what's in the bonnet in this case is nothing, but I have something right here. We're gonna play a little variety on the game called what's under the bonnet. And you know how this works. I'm going to give you a bunch of clues. And as I give you these clues, and I want you to try to shout out to me what you think it is that's under the bonnet. We've put these secret little microphones in your TV. So I'm going to hold my ear when you yell back at the TV, trying to get it all the way here into church this morning to let me know what you think it is. There's not really a microphone, but we'll kind of pretend that there is. Okay, so the first hint that we have for you today is this. What's under the bonnet is really light. What do you think it is? Well, let me hear you shout a little bit. I bet somebody guessed a feather. I bet somebody listening, watching said, I bet it's a feather under there. But I'm going to tell you, it's not a feather. So let me give you another clue. It's not only light, it's also quite thin. It's light and it's thin. What do you think? I don't know if that's it. I don't think that's it. Did somebody guess paper? That's thin and it's light, but it's not paper either. One more clue. I might give you four clues today because it's weird times. It's also off-white, which you might think would be paper, or you could even think would be some kind of a bird's feather, but we already said it wasn't either of those two things. So it's really light, it's thin, it's off-white. What could it be? The last clue is you would wrap something in it. This is really hard. You would wrap something in it. I wonder how many of you at home think you know exactly what this is. In fact, I want you to turn to your parents and ask them if they know what it is, because I bet they might not know what it is either. I tell you what it is, I'm gonna show you. Are you ready? It's not candy, because that's not light thin, or white, or off-white. It's not a feather, I already told you that. Not a piece of paper, I told you that. Here it is. It's actually a big piece of cloth, which isn't super thin or super light, but if you put it into strips, it would be. And this is something similar to, so you can see the light little fabric at the end, the little frayed fabric. But if you went into your kitchen and you grabbed a dish towel, I bet it would be something similar to that. And you tell me, Pastor Chris, why would you have something like this under the bonnet? Well, friends, here's what happened. The scripture tells us, the Bible tells us that when Jesus was crucified, they wrapped his body in a garment like this one, in cloth like this one. But the weirdest thing happened. When Mary went to the tomb in the morning, on Easter morning, that very first Easter morning, and Jesus wasn't there, she went back, she got the disciples, and when the disciples came back with her, namely Peter and John, that's what John's gospel tells us, it says that they went into the tomb, and there were strips. There were strips like this. We would take this fabric and we would rip it, strips that were just lying there. But then at the very top, there was this piece that was wrapped up and folded quite nicely, just like so. And aren't you impressed with how good I fold? It was folded just like so. Of course, it would have been very dirty, because Jesus' crucified body had been wrapped in it. Even his head, which you remember, had the crown of thorns on it. But there it was, all tidy, wrapped up and sitting there right where his head would go. Can you imagine how surprising this would have been for the disciples? I mean, they went there in the morning to try to prepare Jesus' body, expecting to find a body inside this linen wrap. Imagine if you took a dish towel at home, you put a ball in it, and you dropped the ball onto the floor inside that towel. If you picked up the towel, you would expect to see the ball there. Why? Because things don't just disappear. Do you know what? Jesus didn't just disappear either. It wasn't like he was gone and nobody knew where he was. No, he was gone because he was risen and he lives again. That even though on Friday he was crucified, even to the point of death in the tomb, on Sunday he wasn't there because he was no longer dead. And the reason that we have, friends, such great hope at Easter, and in fact, the reason that we have such great hope at any time of the year, regardless of what's going on, is because Jesus is alive. When they went to the tomb, they saw the linen. It was just laying there in a pile except for the one folded cloth at the top, because Jesus was not there anymore. And so there is no reason for him to keep that linen with him. But he left it there so that they would know that he had risen. Friends, that's what we want for you. that you might know in these really weird and different times that our God is risen, that Jesus is risen. And because he is risen, because he's overcome death, we have hope in every single situation. I'm going to talk about that a little more in a little while. But know how glad we are that you're here listening this morning. And we trust that as we continue to go through this time together, whether online, wherever it might be, email or phone calls, that you'll be able to trust God through it all because we serve a risen Savior. Our friends are going to sing now. Why don't you join them in song together? Thanks for being here, boys and girls. We hope to see you really, really, really soon. Bye-bye.
Sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in, when death was arrested my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested, my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new, now life begins with you. Rise from my chains, I'm a prisoner.
Made me new, now life begins with you.
the song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free forever, amen. When death was arrested in my life,
oh, praise.
What a special privilege it is to be able to have so many different people who have ministered to us throughout the course of this week and these past number of weeks. And so let me take just a brief moment to say a big thank you to them. Pastor Dan has been remarkable. Rachel has been remarkable. Andrew has been remarkable. The office staff has been remarkable. Sue Arthur and Jim Murphy have been remarkable in taping. Bob has played numerous times. Rachel has come to sing. Billy has done sound. Steve Hoffman has done sound. We've had so many different people participating in these services. And I know they've been a blessing to you because you've shared that with us. And so I want you to know that we're grateful for you in the same way that you're grateful for what we are doing. And indeed, these are weird and different and difficult times. And we also know that life continues, that things continue to happen and take place in our world. Some have gone through periods of darkness and struggle. I know Kurt Anderson, we're praying for you, buddy, as you continue to rehab from your hip surgery. We have things of difficulty. We also have things of joy. Pepe and Mary Ann, 68 years today. Are you kidding me? 68 years is remarkable. And I hope you're able to celebrate with one another and your family on these days. And so we have the whole realm of life still happening, birthdays and different events that are trying to happen, albeit differently. They're still happening in our world. And if we could maybe put any kind of word on it, any kind of language on it, all of this is so hard to process, isn't it? If we go back a number of weeks, I'm sure none of us would have imagined we'd be where we are today. Not just in the context of our homes on Easter Sunday, I mean, that's weird enough, but the context of our nation and our world, borders shut down, businesses closed, all these different things happening, we would never, a number of weeks ago, been able to imagine it because we've never seen anything like it. And if we try to somehow make sense of it all, I don't know that we can. Oh, we can reach and grasp at straws and try to put some kind of explanation behind it. But in the end, let's be honest, this doesn't really make sense. Or maybe we should say it's hard to make any sense of it. You know, this morning, what I want to be able to do is allow that idea of things not making sense to provide a backdrop for where it is that we want to go together. And I want you to use that word or allow that word to form kind of the basis of our thought process today, even as we think through what God has given us in His Word. I was so proud of the kids earlier who read, and when I called them this week, I said, special base camp meeting, a covert assignment that we needed them to do, and they showed up and they read with such vigor the beginning of Luke's 24th chapter. And as they read through verse number 6, I want to pick up in verse number 9. Again, listening to what it is that Luke has told us about these events and how they unfolded even amongst the disciples who were gathered there. Starting in verse number 9 of Luke chapter 24, we read this. It says, when they came back from the tomb, that is the ladies who had gone in the morning to prepare the body for burial, when they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. All these things, that is, about who had shown up and told them that Jesus wasn't there and then had explained how Jesus had predicted all of these events. Now, it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. Now, here it comes. Verse number 11, but they did not believe the women because their words seemed to them like, there it is, nonsense. They did not believe the women because their words seemed to them like nonsense. You know, in some sense, the disciples who were sitting there and responding to the women in the way that they respond to the women were kind of right. If a bunch of people came back and said what they just said about how they went to the tomb to prepare the body for burial and lo and behold, angels showed up because Jesus wasn't there and they asked him, why are you looking for the women among the dead? And then they went and recounted all the different events and then they said, go tell the others about this. I mean, let's be honest. We look at that and say, that's crazy. What you're saying doesn't make any sense. It's nonsense. And so, in some sense, their lack of belief, their lack of really being willing to embrace what the women were telling them isn't a surprise. In fact, their unwillingness to embrace it makes perfect sense because what the women seemed to be saying was nonsense. It was nonsense, at least from their perspective. But here's what I wanted to ask this morning, and I hope you're able to do this with me at home, wherever you are, wherever it is that you're watching this. Let me ask you this question. Let's just say, hypothetically speaking, that the disciples, in a moment of profound clarity and rationality, decided to step back for a moment and just evaluate this historically. What I mean by that is, let's just say, as people who had been following Christ for 3 long years, learning all of these different lessons, people who certainly had some familiarity, probably a lot more than some, with Jewish law, with Old Testament scriptures, with the God of our Bible, let's just say for a second that they were able to step back for a moment and say, okay, let's just handle this rationally. How is it that God has worked throughout history? And let's just say they added one more question to that. Has God ever acted before in a nonsensical manner? You know what I love about that word? One is I didn't make it up. It's a great word, and it's super fun to just say. And has God ever acted in a nonsensical manner? At least, again, listen to this all unfold, at least from the perspective of one who's sitting in a seat before the events unfold. Has God ever acted or moved or allowed things to happen in our world that from the perspective of one sitting there before the events unfold seem to make absolutely no sense? Has God ever done that before? This week, I went up with Suzanne. She was sitting in the back room, and I said, you know, Susie, has God ever acted in a nonsensical manner? And of course, we just started laughing at this. Because if you think about it, and you just have to give me the freedom and the liberty to be able to do this today, if you think about it, you know that history is replete with God working in ways that don't seem to make any sense to the people with whom God is interacting. Particularly when those situations or those circumstances are viewed from the perspective of one who is yet to go through the events. Sure, we can look back on them and say, oh, that makes perfect sense. But for the one who's sitting on this side of the event, when God is calling them into some kind of activity or action or allowing some kind of thing to happen around them, it seems like absolute nonsense. You say, well, what do you mean? Well, I have a pretty long list. It's coronavirus, COVID-19. We have nothing but time, so I'm going to be able to work through this list here today. I'll do it quickly. But think for yourself, if you go back into time, how do you think it would have felt to be Noah? God shows up to Noah and tells Noah, Noah, I'm going to destroy the earth with a flood, and so please build an ark. And you're going to preserve your family and all of the animals on the ark when the rains come. Everybody else is going to drown, but you're going to live. And so Noah goes out and begins to build this ark in faith. What do you think the people around Noah were saying in that moment? They're like, oh, you know what? No, that's a really good idea. I thought about building a big boat one time too, but I decided against it. I'm glad you're carrying it out. Are you kidding me? They would have said, Noah, that doesn't make any sense. How's that even possible? What about Abraham? When he's first called in Genesis 12, God comes to him and he says, Abram, I want you to leave everything. Leave your family behind. I want you to go to the land I'm going to show you. So Abram has to go to his wife Sarah and says, Sarah, you know what? Things are great. Sarai, things are great, but we need to leave. You think she said, oh, of course, that sounds great. No, that call made no sense. Later, as God continues his promises to Abram, he says, I'm going to make you the father of many nations. But Abraham looks at himself and he's old, and Sarah looks at herself and she says, I'm old. And so when the messenger comes to Abraham and Sarai and says, you are going to have a child by this time next year. Remember what Sarah does in the tent over to the side. Says she laughs. Why? Because what the angels were saying was nonsense. It didn't make any sense to her. How can this even be? We continue to journey through Genesis into Exodus. We come to Moses. God shows up with Moses in a burning bush. There it is, off to the side. The bush is burning, and yet it's not. Which, if you remember, in Moses' mind says, this makes no sense. So he goes over and inquires of the bush, and there it is. The Lord is saying, take off your shoes. You're standing on holy ground. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to go to Pharaoh. You want me to what? Yeah, you're going to go to Pharaoh, but that doesn't make any sense. You get how this picture continues to unfold. The Israelites then are led. They're delivered into the wilderness. They're freed from Egyptian slavery and control. They're pinned against the Red Sea. The Egyptians coming after them. Susan's done this with the kids this past week. And there they are. And God says, as the people are grumbling and saying, oh no, here we've come to die. What does God tell Moses? Here's what I want you to do. I want you to take your staff and just strike the sea. You're kind of like, what? Come on. That's nonsense. And then the winds are going to blow. And Moses telling the people, yeah, God's going to deliver us from the hand. They're like, we're dead. We're dead. We can't win. This doesn't make any sense. But then Moses strikes the sea and it parts. They go into the wilderness further. What does God do but provide manna from heaven every single day? That doesn't make any sense, but God does it. Goes even further into the book of Judges. There's more times we could do this. Go through the wilderness. They come into the promised land. With Joshua. And as they get into the promised land, they have to take over Jericho. So what does God tell them they want? What does God tell the Israelites he wants them to do? Here we go. Walk around the city 7 times and then give a really loud shout. Oh, that makes perfect sense. It doesn't make any sense. This is, in fact, if you were to go back there to a reporter at the time, and Moses gets his generals together and says, I'm sorry, Joshua gets his generals together and says, okay, here's the plan. We're going to walk around the city 7 times, and then we're going to give loud shouts, and then the city is going to be ours. Do you think the guys are there saying, this is a perfect plan? I couldn't have thought of a better plan myself. No, it makes no sense. It makes no sense. Go into the book of Judges with Gideon. And as Gideon is there, he has this big army, 32,000 men, but they're outnumbered 4-1 by their enemy. And so God comes to Gideon and he says to Gideon, you know what, Gideon, even though you're outnumbered 4-1, here's what I want you to do. I want you to make your army a little smaller. And you got to think to yourself, Gideon's saying, what? You want me to do what? In fact, if we want to put the language of today on it, do you think Gideon might have wanted to say, God, that makes no sense? But God whittles his army down first to 10,000, and then he whittles it down all the way from 32,000 people to 300. Friends, they were outnumbered at 32,000. What do you think is happening at 300? And again, a lot of people are leaving Gideon's army. You know why? Because they're saying this makes no sense. Israel later asks for a king. You see where this is going. Israel later asks for a king. And the king is Saul first, but then now Saul's, that's bad news. And so they move on to the next king, Jesse's son. And so Samuel goes to Jesse and says, show me your sons because one of your sons is going to be king. So Jesse goes and he gets all his sons. He carts them before Samuel. That's not it. No, he's not it. You know, that's not, he's not, no, no good. Next. Now, I mean, all the way through Jesse's sons. Until Samuel finally says, do you have anybody else? And Samuel says, well, I guess there's David. But even his own father, Jesse, says, this doesn't even make any sense. It makes no sense. But David comes in and sure enough, what happens? He's the guy. He's the guy. Listen, if we want to step back far enough from it, and we want to just evaluate things from a reasonable, even rational, historical perspective, here's what we have to acknowledge. That God has a history of working in nonsensical manners. In ways, friends, that just don't make sense. And let's say this, and we have to be honest about it. He doesn't just work in nonsensical ways when all these great scenes of victory. God also called Babylon to judge Israel. Painful for the prophets. And they're looking at God saying, God, this doesn't make sense. God also put a thorn in Paul's side. That's not exactly pleasant. Paul had to say, this just doesn't make sense. Why isn't God removing this from me? The blind man, I think it's in John chapter 8, living his whole life as one blind, that people want to know, what's he done wrong? That's the only sense they can make. Otherwise, one being blind doesn't make any sense. There's moments of great power and conquest, victory, but there's also moments that are really, really difficult. But if we put them together and we examine them as a whole, we must say to ourselves that oftentimes God works in a way that doesn't make sense. So if we bring our way all the way back into Luke's gospel, even on Easter Sunday, when the women are coming back from the tomb and saying it's empty, he's not there, the angel said he is risen, and why are you looking for him here? And the disciples, for the disciples to sit back and say, well, that doesn't make any sense. That might be the first clue that God is up to something. Because God often doesn't make sense in what he does and at times at what he allows. But you can testify to that. As you've walked through times yourself as people, as individuals, in your own homes, in your own lives, in our current state of the world, isn't it true that sometimes we step back and we say to ourselves, this just doesn't make any sense? And sometimes our hearts then in those moments grieve before God as we pour out our hearts, say, God, this doesn't make any sense. This doesn't make any sense. Why? But let me ask you this. If we look back then, next, over the history of God's creation and over the history of God's interaction with his creation, namely even his redeemed, his own people, what's his track record? In other words, when things don't seem to make sense, just scripturally speaking, what happens? You see, as I began to look over this and consider it, even in preparation for this morning, what one can't deny is this. Even when, maybe you say particularly when, God didn't seem to make sense, wasn't it true that the end result always achieved his purposes? Even when God didn't make sense from the perspective of one sitting before the events unfolded, even when the situation didn't make sense, seemed nonsensical in and of itself, the reality is, as one comes around on the other side and looks back on the event that just was, from God's perspective, from his interactions with history in history, the reality is God's purposes were always fulfilled, even when it seemed to not make sense at the beginning. If I understand this, that this is the way that God has worked repeatedly, countless times over history, and I'm sure you could have added numerous instances of your own from God's word where what he was calling for didn't seem to make sense, what he was allowing didn't seem to make sense, and yet at the end somehow achieved his purposes. In fact, I bet you can't go through the scripture and find one instance where God didn't make sense or did make sense, and in the end his purpose wasn't fulfilled. No, why? Because God always fulfills his purposes, whether the things seem to make sense or they don't. So where does that bring us? This is important. If it's true, just allow this. Again, try not to figure out where I'm going. Try not to hyper-analyze this in your mind. Just think about this. Just think about this from a reasonable perspective. If God historically has worked in ways that don't seem to make sense, whether that is in allowing events or in having his hand creating the event, whatever one you want to look at, if God historically has allowed things to happen that from our perspective don't make sense, But then, in that moment, always uses those things that don't seem to make sense to achieve his purposes, even in our world. Where does that leave us? What I would argue is this. It leaves us in a place that says, if God is allowing or bringing about something that doesn't seem to make sense, I can still move forward in the nonsense, believing that God's purposes are going to be achieved. That God is doing something to achieve his purposes in me. In other words, I can take, even when things don't seem to make sense, I can take that one small step forward, that next small step forward, that next small step forward. And I know sometimes steps are hard. They're hard in life when things are happening as they're happening, but I can take these steps forward because even though they don't make sense, I know that God has a history of not making sense, yet even in that nonsensical stuff, still achieving his purposes and his will in all things. And so I can take these little steps of faith, these little steps of obedience, even if I'm uncertain as to where they might go, I can still walk along this path, trusting that God is doing something and his purposes are still going to be achieved. Now, friends, let me tell you that this, again, covers the whole gamut of life. This covers the one who is still on the outside of faith, looking in, wondering, what's this all about? And I know that for those of you who are in that place, and there are many in our world, for those of you who are in that place of looking in on the church, looking in on this day, looking in on Easter, and hearing this story of a person dead but rising again, that doesn't make any sense. At least from the one who is before there, before that place. But you go and you talk to somebody who has then received him, receive the grace that he offers. You say, oh, radically changed my life. Didn't make sense before, but that's because I was in a different perspective. Now as I look back on it, it makes perfect sense. For the one saying, as we talk about the wonder of the gospel, which is this Jesus coming to forgive sin that I might have life, a life that I've never known, it can be awkward to take that first little bitty step to say, admit my sin. Why would I acknowledge my sin before a holy and righteous God? I mean, that just seems weird. It doesn't even seem to make sense. It doesn't. From a certain perspective. Until I'm able to take that step saying, God, I don't understand how this is working. I don't understand what's going to happen, but here's what I know. I'm a sinner, and I need your forgiveness. Can I tell you that I sat in my office with somebody just a couple of weeks ago who had grown up in the church, his whole life in the church, never confessed his sin before, never once. This seems awkward. Why would I do that? From that perspective, I don't need, that doesn't make sense. But then we begin to read God's word and we realize that sometimes the things that God calls us to don't make sense, but in the end they make perfect sense. He moves forward and you know what? God has transformed his life. This is what happens. We take these one little bitty steps of faith, trusting that somehow God is achieving his purposes. This happens in life. It's not only at the beginning of our faith where we're coming to understand who God is and what he's done through his son. It's not only that conversional type experience where I come to know the gospel, the freedom that comes from having my sins forgiven. This is also true of the individual who's been walking with the Lord for a long time, who's already in this place of establishment. And you know, too, that we can get stuck even as believers. You want me to actually forgive those who have hurt me? If I forgive them, then they're free to go. It doesn't make any sense to forgive. This is the call, right? This God calls us to things that don't make sense. And yet, if you talk to someone who got to that place where they were simply controlled by the bitterness inside of them over what someone had done to them and got to the place by God's grace where they were able to forgive, it was a freedom like they'd never experienced before. Look at it. It's the same pattern, friends. In the beginning, it doesn't seem to make sense because God calls us to things sometimes that don't seem to make sense. But at the end, when we look back and say, oh, it makes perfect sense. You can put it in the realm of loving one another. I know sometimes that's hard. We're in places now, some of you in places now, you haven't been with your home, with your families, all the, I mean, to be able to love one another just sometimes doesn't seem to make sense. Particularly after how you've been treated or what they've done. God says, love your enemies. You say at the beginning, that doesn't even make sense. I know. But even though it doesn't make sense, doesn't mean that as you look back on it, you would think the same. No, we can take these little steps of faith according to what God has called us to, because we know that sometimes he does things, oftentimes he does things, most times he does things that just don't seem to make sense. But in the end, achieve his will. Now, here's what you need to know. You need to know this. That just because I'm walking in this kind of faithful way doesn't mean it's always going to be roses. And this is hard. We're going through unprecedented times right now. And I can't say, I won't say, I would never stand up here and say that just because these things don't seem to make sense and I move forward in faith, that doesn't mean necessarily that it's going to achieve the purpose that I want it to achieve, at least in the moment. The reality is, and we've talked about this as a staff, that there are some businesses that aren't going to make it through this time. Even though you've tried to be nothing but faithful in how you lived out your life and conducted your business. I wish I could say it differently, but we don't know that it's going to happen. There could be some that lose their businesses. That's really hard, and I'm not going to minimize that. There's still going to be death. Even as I'm walking in faith, people are still going to die, sometimes for explainable reasons, sometimes for non-explainable reasons, beyond our control. Just because I'm walking in faith doesn't mean that it all works out magically in that moment the way that we want it to. There's still going to be difficulty and hardship because sin is still prevalent in our world. And in those moments of loss with occupational stuff, in those moments of loss with relational stuff, in those moments of strain with relation, in all of these different moments, we can say this just doesn't make sense. Our seniors are wondering that this doesn't make sense. I don't get to go back to school. It's such a bummer. Yeah, it doesn't make sense. I'll be the first to acknowledge that. But I also want to be the first to acknowledge that if I step back from it far enough and look at it reasonably without the emotion that can get caught up within me, I also have to realize that sometimes God works the biggest and the greatest in those moments that don't mean to make sense, achieving his will. And even if then I lose in the midst of the process, ultimately even my own life, do you think that those who have lost their lives in the Lord will look back and say, well, that didn't work out so well? Not a chance. No, because even though here on this side, from our perspective, it didn't work out, from those who have the hope of Christ, the hope of the resurrection, the glory of a risen Lord, what we know is that as we look back, this is exactly how it was supposed to work out. Hallelujah, I am with my Savior forever. You see this? You see this? It's not always, and I know it's not always times of rejoicing. It's not always times of wonder. It's not always times of laughter. It's not always times of any of these things. But it can be time of faith and trust and hope. Why? Because when those women went to the tomb to search for this dead Jesus, they didn't find him. And the reason they didn't find him was because he was alive and well. You don't think on Friday as they looked up at the crucified Christ, they said, this doesn't make sense. He was the Messiah, the Savior of the world. No, it makes no sense. And as they went to the tomb, it made no sense. But then they experienced the risen Lord throughout the remainder of the gospel, throughout the book of Acts, throughout the New Testament, and throughout the centuries that have gone since. Testimonies even in this church would be too numerous to count of people who have seen the faithfulness of God even in situations that didn't make sense. I have hope in every situation, whether it ends the way that I want or not, because God works through the things that don't make sense, even crazy things like viruses that overwhelm our world. Do I know how? I don't. But all I can do, whether personally, whether corporately, whether congregationally, is take one daily step at a time. trusting that the God who often works in things that don't make sense is going to work in this thing that doesn't make sense too and achieve his purposes for his glory. Friends, we serve a risen Savior. And so even though our hearts may be heavy on this day, we can rejoice because our King is alive. He lives and he reigns, not only in the heavens, but within his people. Because of that, my heart can sing. May you be able to sing this weekend as well. As you walk through life with a whole new, I pray, degree of hope in who Christ is and what he's done, even though it might not make sense on this side, trusting that it will someday make sense when I'm able to look back and see it. Let's pray together. Father, you are a remarkable God. You are a remarkable King who loves his people with his whole heart, with his whole mind, who loves us with everything you are. And Father, we confess today, I confess today, that it is sometimes so hard to see you. And as we go through life in these moments that just don't seem to make sense, whether we're viewing them from afar or whether we're walking through the fire personally, it's been hard to trust you. Father, intermixed in all of this are stories of profound faith where people have been willing to gather at the foot of the cross, at your feet, casting their cares, their concerns, their anxieties upon you, and you have met them in this place that doesn't make sense. And we rejoice in that, but some of us just aren't there yet. And so I pray that you might bring us there, even on this Easter Sunday, where we're able to step back far enough to be able to acknowledge you as God, as King, as Lord, as one who lives and reigns and is over all things. As we come to that understanding of who you are and a whole new sense of hope and confidence, we might be able to face this day and then the next day as they come, trusting that you are achieving your purposes. Might that kind of hope give us a peace that we can only find in you, a confidence that we can only find in you, and even beneath it all, a joy that can only be found in you. Help us to serve you. And as we serve you and follow you in faith, may we then love one another as well. For that's how you've called us to live. But we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Believe in the Son. I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power of his blood. See?
He has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and of a sound mind. What a wonderful, wonderful message. Let's bow before the Lord in our closing prayer time together. Heavenly Father, we thank you that because your Son, Jesus Christ, lives, because he rose again from the dead, we can face tomorrow. And there will be a tomorrow. Certainly there will be a tomorrow in eternity for every single one of us. But there's also a tomorrow for us here in this place for as long as you give us days as well. Father, I do pray that you would continue graciously, put your hedge of thorns of protection above and below and all around the broader congregation, all those who are part of this service this morning, and their neighbors as well, and those to our east particularly who are affected. You know each and every single one. I thank you, Lord, that you are close to the brokenhearted. I thank you that you save or even deliver, as it were, those who are crushed in spirit. Lord, those who are small business owners, those who are employees, those who are parts of the congregation who may have financial needs, may have physical needs. You know each and every one. Maybe it's relationship needs, even within the family or outside, whatever it might be. Lord Jesus, we ask that you would graciously be there for each and every one. And we thank you that you are, because you never leave us or forsake us. And Lord, come into the hearts of those that need to have you in their hearts, even as we heard in the message just a few minutes ago, that we would humbly acknowledge, yes, we are sinful people, but you are a Savior. You are a deliverer for each and every one of us who calls upon you, and you turn none of us away. So we thank you, Lord, that as we go into these days ahead, we don't need to be filled with fear, but we can be filled with that childlike faith and dependence upon you that you give to each one of us. So bless us now as we have the rest of our Easter day with our loved ones, and as we go into the new week ahead. And Father, we ask that you would graciously resurrect the situation that we are in our lives and in our world, and that there would be better days ahead according to your gracious timing and according to your will, because you live. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, Jesus Christ, and of the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. And our benediction today is that wonderful chorus, "Because he lives," join with us at home.
Easter.